His story, the story of Jesus Christ, that's our story too. It's not just a story about some guy who lived on the other side of the world 2,000 years ago. This story is our story. It defines who we are. When you put your faith in Christ, you don't just believe in him. You take on his life, his death, his resurrection, his mission, his sufferings, his inheritance, and his privileges. And when you believe in Jesus, you see the world differently. And you see your own life differently as well. And your mission in life, then, looks a lot like his mission in his life. So if you want to turn with me to Mark chapter 8, that's what we're going to read today. Mark 8, we're going to start at verse 31. He then began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders, chief priests, and teachers of the law, and that he must be killed and after 3 days rise again. He spoke plainly about this, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But when Jesus turned and looked at his disciples, he rebuked Peter. "Get behind me, Satan," he said. "You do not have in mind the things of God, but the things of men." And he called the crowd to him, along with his disciples, and said, "If anyone would come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for me and for the gospel will save it. What good is it for a man to gain the whole world, yet forfeit his soul? Or what can a man give in exchange for his soul? If anyone is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, the Son of Man will be ashamed of him when he comes in his Father's glory with the holy angels." And that's where we'll stop. This section here in Mark, this is actually a turning point in the Gospel of Mark. If you were to read Mark from beginning to end, this would be a moment where things start to change. Up until this point, Jesus was coming in with guns blazing, spiritual guns, so to speak. He was driving out demons, he was healing people, he was teaching, he had tons of crowds following him, and everything was going great, and he was amazing. He was walking on water, multiplying food for all these people. He was just coming in, guns blazing, and everything was going well. And now this happens. And it kind of helps if you know the end of the story. But he starts to suddenly talk to them straightforward and plain language. He usually talks in parables, but this time he's talking very plainly and straightforward. "Everybody is going to reject me and kill me, and I'm going to rise again," is what he's saying now. This is very counterintuitive to the way our minds think. Somebody asked me one time, you know, why Christianity when there's all these other religions out there? And there's many ways to answer that question. But one thing that's interesting about Christianity is that it's very counterintuitive. It doesn't fit the way that we normally would do things. It's fascinating that so many people actually believe Jesus and would follow him when this is the kind of stuff that he talked about. Who would want to sign up for something like that? Unless it was real. Jesus' mission was rejection and death to save sinners. That was his mission. With all of this stuff that he did, it could have been a very different story. With his miracles, his preaching, his power over demons, he could have ruled the world. Easy. All he had to do was do these things in front of enough people, and everybody would have been like, "Whoa, this guy's the Son of God." He could have commanded all people's respect. He could have received all kinds of money and offerings from all over the world. He could have written definitive books on every topic out there. He's the Son of God. I mean, think about what he knew. He could have eradicated diseases and disabilities. He could have overthrown all the corrupt rulers that were around at that time. There were tons of people in power oppressing a lot of other people. He could have reversed all that rampant injustice. And he did none of that. That seems weird. Instead, he surrendered everything and faced rejection, insult, injury, suffering, and death, and disappointed everybody. This was not what they were looking for. This is not what they wanted. But that was his mission. And that's what he did. It's very counterintuitive. Look at the screen here with me, if you would, and let's answer the question together. The second part is on the next slide. Why is he called Christ, meaning anointed? Because he has been ordained by God the Father and has been anointed with the Holy Spirit to be our chief prophet and teacher, who perfectly reveals to us the secret counsel and will of God for our deliverance. Our only high priest, who has set us free by the one sacrifice of his body, and who continually pleads our cause with the Father, and our eternal King, who governs us by his word and spirit, and who guards us and keeps us in the freedom he has won for us. I don't know if you noticed it in there, but it says there are three things that Jesus is. He's a prophet, he's a priest, and he's a king. In the Old Testament, if you know those stories, there were prophets and priests and kings, and they had important functions in drawing the people to God. And Jesus is all of them. So as a prophet, he spoke the Father's truth at great cost to himself. He didn't just say whatever he wanted to. He said what God the Father told him to say. And he said that very thing to us, actually, in John 12, 49 and 50. He says this, it's on the screen, "For I did not speak of my own accord, but the Father who sent me commanded me what to say and how to say it. I know that his command leads to eternal life, so whatever I say is just what the Father has told me to say." So Jesus comes with a message from heaven, and he repeats it and he explains it. This is who God is. This is how you are to live for him. And this truth that he conveyed, he spoke this truth to his death. In fact, it was by telling the truth that he was convicted and was killed. It was his own truthful words that condemned him to death. In Mark 14, 61 through 65, again the high priest asked him, "Are you the Christ, the Son of the Blessed One?" "I am," said Jesus, "and you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the Mighty One and coming on the clouds of heaven." The high priest tore his clothes. "Why do we need any more witnesses?" he asked. "You have heard the blasphemy. What do you think?" They all condemned him as worthy of death. Then some began to spit at him. They blindfolded him, struck him with their fists, and said, "Prophesy." And the guards took him and beat him. He was just telling the truth. "Are you the Christ? Are you the Son of God?" "I am." And it's ironic that they command him to prophesy there, mockingly, because he was prophesying and he was testifying to the truth of who he really was. He was a prophet. He communicated God's truth to us, even though it cost him his life. As a priest, he offered his life to make us righteous. The priests in the Old Testament, they would offer up animal sacrifices, and they would go through these rituals, and they would go through all this stuff to remind everybody that when you sin, this means death. And when an animal gives his life for you, that means life for you. They would go through all this to point ahead to who Jesus was. It wasn't just an empty exercise. It meant to point to something. So just like baptism here, this is not an empty exercise. This means to point us to something that we can't see. Something that's a spiritual reality, but is no less real than water on us. So these other priests, they offer animals. But Jesus, as a priest, he offered himself. As a priest, he goes between us and God. Sin separates us from God. Jesus goes right in between us so that he can intercede for us. He went to bat on our behalf at great cost to himself. He died doing it. And even to this day, he intercedes for us. He intercedes for us in heaven before the Father. And all of our access to God the Father is through him. When we pray, we don't pray in our name. We pray in Jesus' name. Because he is our communication with God the Father. He's kind of our cell tower, if you will, that allows us to communicate with God the Father. Otherwise, we'd have nothing. We would have no connection. As a king, he used his power to save, and he used his authority to serve. He was a king who actually served like a slave. That's weird. That doesn't make sense to us. Real kings that we know, rulers that we know, usually they serve themselves. They talk themselves up, and back then especially, they dominated everybody else. They sucked everybody else of all their resources, their money and everything. And if you were ruling, you took advantage of people. That's how it was. And here comes Jesus, and he is serving like a slave. Like a slave. He used his authority to defeat sin. He used his authority to scatter demons and evil and give life-giving commands. And even to this day, he rules us so that we would be free from sin and that tyranny and fear. He still rules at the right hand of God in heaven to this day. He's our king. Jesus said in John 6:38, "For I have come down from heaven not to do my will, but to do the will of him who sent me." He was here to serve. Instead of taking advantage of his power, he used it to help us. His mission wasn't what we wanted or expected. It was following the Father. He was doing not his own will, but the will of him who sent him. And submitting to that will, even though it cost him his life and everything else. The people at that time, and us to this day, if we're honest with each other, we want kingdoms. He gave us a cross. We want glory. He showed us humility. We want fame, and he gives us the Father. He's about something completely different than what we and everybody are usually looking for. We want Jesus. We're kind of the same way. We want Jesus to give us wealth, health, and happiness. That's the salvation that we want. We want to have an easy life, we want to feel good, and we want to have the things that we want. And when we think of salvation, that's what we think of. We want perfectly healthy bodies, we want easy victories, we want to succeed at everything we do, we want to achieve all our ambitions, we want to gain respect from all of our peers. We want to have excellent educations for our children and to have them be healthy and wealthy too. We want to have family live nearby and we want to own the best and latest and greatest of everything. And we figure that our success will demonstrate God's salvation. Our wealth will serve God's kingdom. And those, not like those things are terrible things. It's not that we can't pursue them or we can't have them. But is that what Jesus was about? In verse 34, the real Jesus offers us the cross. If you want to come after me, then deny yourself. Take up the cross and follow me. In the Greek, there's actually the word "the" in front of cross. Take up the cross. The cross. The one that I'm going to take up. His success was measured not by what he gained, by what he lost. And he lost everything. He didn't even have any clothes on his back at the end. Whoever wants to save his life will lose it, he says in verse 35. Whoever loses his life for me and for the gospel will save it. He measured success entirely different than the way we do. And then he said, follow me. Do it this way. Not the way that everybody else is going and not the way that you would normally think of. Go this way. Follow me. He gave his life to death on a cross. And as a result, God exalted him to the highest place. He gave him the name that is above every name. And then one day, at the name of Jesus, every knee is going to hit the dirt. In heaven and on earth and under the earth, every tongue that's ever lived is going to confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. That's Jesus. That was his life. Let's look at the screen here again. Why are you called a Christian? Because by faith I am a member of Christ, and so I share in his anointing. I am anointed to confess his name, to present myself to him as a living sacrifice of thanks, to strive with a good conscience against sin and the devil in this life, and afterward to reign with Christ over all creation for all eternity. So, Jesus is a prophet, priest, and king. We are Christians, so we are prophets, priests, and kings. We are anointed to confess his name. As priests, we present ourselves to him as living sacrifices of thanks. And as kings, we strive against the devil and evil in this life. And we will one day reign with Christ over all creation forever. And you being called a Christian means we share in his anointing to do the things that he did. So for us, for me, as a Christian, I share in Christ's anointing. In 1 John 2, verse 20, it says, you have an anointing from the Holy One, and all of you know the truth. In John, truth is usually a person. You know the truth means that you know Jesus Christ, who is the truth, who testified to it. And the word Christian, it means to be like Christ. If you call yourself a Christian, that means that you are like Christ. That means you walk the way that he did. You live the way he did. And you had the priorities that he did and the mission that he had. Christians are not just an adherence to some religion. There's lots of religions, and there's lots of adherence to them. But being a Christian is not just simply an agreement with a belief system of some kind. We are actually the embodiment of Christ on earth. Many times in the Bible it talks about all believers being a body of Christ and how we serve each other and we serve the world. We are the hands and feet of Christ here. 1 Corinthians 6, do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ himself? Put very strongly, your bodies are members of Christ himself. As a prophet, my words are declarations of his goodness and truth. So as we are prophets, sharing in his anointing, the words we speak are declarations of his goodness and truth, or they need to be. In human nature, you know, if we're just not paying attention anyways, our words usually are about praising ourselves. We're about declaring truth that's flattering to us, not necessarily things that might make us look bad. And we recount events of our own triumph and our personal virtue. So our words are really about praising ourselves, usually. We make ourselves look good by the stories we tell and the facts that we share. Jesus didn't praise himself. He spoke truth, but he never really talked himself up. In fact, that passage where he read in Mark, where he was asked point blank, are you the Son of God? And he said, I am. That's the only time he really admitted that he was the Son of God. Most of the time he referred to himself as the Son of Man. He had to be backed into a corner to even admit that he was the Son of God. He didn't praise himself. Our words must always reflect the truth of our God. Just as Jesus told the truth, we need to be people who tell the truth also. Ephesians 4:25. Therefore, each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to his neighbor, for we are all members of one body. We belong to Christ. He's a God of truth. Therefore, we need to reflect that truth. It says later, do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. That was everything that Jesus said. What's going to help these people? What's going to benefit them, and what's going to draw them nearer to God? That's what I'm going to say. That's what I'm going to teach. Those are the stories that I'm going to tell. So our words need to praise the Lord, not ourselves. Our stories need to reveal his goodness, not ours. And our history needs to show his victories in spite of our weaknesses. So when you arrive safely at a destination, that's not because you have great driving skills. It's because God brought you there safely. You can have the greatest driving skills in the world and have somebody run a red light. When you get a job that you really want or that you really need, that's not because you have great skills at interviewing or a great resume. It's because God intervened and made it happen. There's a lot of people with a lot of great resumes that don't get jobs. When you're able to get up from bed in the morning, that's not because you're so great and healthy. It's because God gave you health and strength. God is giving you another day. Still remember visiting once with Ben Miedema, and he was starting to lose his strength. And he would tell me this a number of times, every day I get up and I thank God for another day. And you tend to notice that when you're losing your strength, but it's really true for all of us. No matter how young or old we are, God gives us another day. So as a prophet, let's make sure our words proclaim the truth of Jesus Christ and who he is. As a priest, My life is a living sacrifice of gratitude. Jesus offered his life for all of us, for our salvation. Our lives are living sacrifices in gratitude for what he's already done for us. Romans 12:1, this is your Bible reading track for today. Therefore, I urge you, brothers, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship. We are priests. Our lives need to be living sacrifices of thanks. So every moment of every day needs to be, thank you, Lord, for saving me and making me yours. That goes against our human nature. Our human nature is to serve ourselves, to meet our own needs, to satisfy our own desires, to feed our own cravings, and we will give so that we can take. Jesus said, give without expecting to get anything in return. He was once at this banquet, and there were lots of high, important people here, and they were all going for these highest seats, and he said, hey, maybe take the lowest seat next time. And then he also said, when you give a luncheon or dinner, do not invite your friends, your brothers or relatives, or your rich neighbors. If you do, they might invite you back, and you will be repaid. When you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind. These are people who are destitute on the side of the road. And you will be blessed. Although they cannot repay you, you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous. Give to people who can't pay you back. And intercede in prayer for those who don't know the Lord. There's plenty of those too. Pray to God on their behalf. Just like Jesus intercedes for us and goes between us and God when we were sinners, we need to pray for people who don't know the Lord so that they would know the Lord. As Jesus always lives to intercede for us, we need to intercede for others. And sometimes that takes a long time. With my grandpa, my mom's dad, it took about 30 years. But it happened. He accepted Christ when he was in his 60s. So we are prophets, we are priests, and we are kings. As king, my hands and feet move with his authority to build his kingdom. We are told to be imitators of God as dearly loved children and live a life of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us. We're here to serve. We have power, we have authority, we have position, we have means and resources. We are kings. Are you going to use your power, your resources, your authority, your position, your possessions? Are you going to use that to enrich yourself and make yourself look good? To advance your own kingdom? Or are you going to use that to advance God's kingdom? God's rule and authority looks very different than what we would expect. In our human nature, we want to build our own kingdoms. We want to acquire land. We want to build our castle or our houses. We want to subdue others. We want to demand our rights. We want to win respect, and we want to be the greatest. That's our human nature. If we're not paying attention, that's what we're after. That's the opposite of what Jesus was about. Even at the very last supper that Jesus had with his disciples, they were still arguing about who was the greatest. Said a dispute broke out among them about who is the greatest at the very end. They still didn't get it. They still had that human nature there. But Jesus washed his disciples' feet at that last supper, including the one who betrayed him and handed him over to death. So in Christ, we are kings insofar as we serve. We can have lots of stuff. We can have lots of power. We can have lots of people who respect us. But we are kings in Christ only insofar as we serve other people and we're building his kingdom. At that Last Supper, he said to the disciples, "You know, the kings of the Gentiles, they lord it over them, and those exercise authority over them call themselves benefactors, but you are not to be like that. Instead, the greatest among you should be like the youngest, and the one who rules like the one who serves. For who is greater, the one who sits at the table or the one who serves? Is it not the one who's at the table? But I am one among you who serves. I'm not sitting at the table. I'm washing your feet." So instead of using our power and authority for ourselves, let's use it in service to God to build His kingdom. So what does God want to accomplish in your life? When you look around, what would God want to accomplish? What would demonstrate God's goodness in this world? What would show His truth to more people? So my mission is not what I want or expect, but following my Savior. We have things we want, we have things we expect. That's not our mission, though. Our mission is to follow our Savior. Once again, if anyone would come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross, the cross, and follow me. You are what you go after. Instead of going after things that you want, go after the things that God wants. If you have Christ, your mission in life will look like His. His story is our story. And let's bow our heads together. Lord our God in heaven, thank you for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, and thank you for all that He is, all that He has done for us. We pray, Lord, that as He has led an example of what it means to be a prophet, priest, and king, we pray that we would also be prophets, priests, and kings, even as He was, and that, Lord, our lives and our missions would seek to serve You and to build Your kingdom, that we would take up our crosses, that we would follow Him. In Jesus' name, amen.